1. I have a roommate who has their child with them half of the week. The child is very young, toddler early childhood age, and I agree to letting him stay with me under the impression that they are clean and quiet people. I know children are never really quiet, but as someone who has raised quite a few, I don't mind noise. There are issues with our living situation now regarding cleanliness, bringing bugs into the house, and general treatment of my space. The safety of the child has become a huge issue for me. My roommate and I don't really communicate much aside from the usual hi and do you want to shower first? So this is going to be a difficult conversation for us to have, however it needs to happen. Here is a list of the offenses. The other day I came home from work and walked in the kitchen and noticed that there were pills on the floor. Not the big supplement pills, but tiny white pills. I'm not suggesting she's a drug addict or anything, but I grew concerned when I noticed more than one pill on the floor. I cleaned the bathroom and saw packaged needles on the floor, individual needles in a small container, how they have in a doctor's office, just laying on the floor in the bathroom. I immediately picked them up and interrupted their phone call and asked what the needles were and why they were just on the floor. They said that the needles were for piercings. Okay. I got home from work and saw that my kitchen scissors were laying open on my couch. My animal immediately jumped on the couch and landed on the scissors. I have a small blowtorch that I use for cooking, and I keep on a high shelf so the child can't reach it. The other day I found the blowtorch on the floor. There is lost weed in the apartment. They cannot find their weed and suspect the child maybe got into it. These are just a few of the things that have alarmed me, as the child is not supervised often. The roommate will often be in one room and leave the child to entertain themselves, or will yell at the child to leave them alone if they are doing something. We are having a discussion soon regarding the condition they are leaving my house in, and how, since they moved in, I now have roaches. With this discussion being scheduled, I need to address my concerns, but I don't know how to bring it up, as this is not my child. However, the welfare of the child while they are living in my house is my concern, because God forbid something happened to them. It will have been under my roof with me being a witness to all this. Please, any tips or advice is welcome. I do want to edit this to say I looked up the needles and they are indeed piercing needles. Also, just based off this person and how they act in their day-to-day routines, I don't think they're shooting anything. I may be wrong, but they have given me no indication that they use needles to do drugs. I still don't know what the pills are, but I will find out later. Edit, pills are an anti-anxiety medication. 2. Okay. So I met my roommate on Discord back in 2018, and she lived in Ohio. We became great friends, and then last July we got an apartment together, and she moved to where I am currently. I've had a difficult life and went from living with a pedophile to my boyfriend, who broke up with me and decided to get physical, finally getting my own place. Unfortunately, an apartment is not cheap and I needed a roommate. The beginning was great, no problems. The first problem occurred when she complained that it was too cold all the time with the AC. I grew up with the AC on all the time to keep the place cool and put more clothes on otherwise. She complained, and my current boyfriend's mom ended up getting a fan for me, so I wouldn't have to deal with it, and we agreed on 71 degrees all the time. Unfortunately, she likes to turn it up and the heat in the apartment up all the time, and I burn out. Her boyfriend lived with us for a little bit too, and I could not undress as much as I would have liked. He left about 2 weeks ago to live in his own apartment. Recently, though, I had to call the cops on her and get her sent to a psychiatric ward and a bunch of other shit. As soon as she got back, she flipped on me, like a week later for it, when she is the one who decided to be home alone and talking suicidal. I have too much stuff on me to deal with her issues. We got into a complete argument with her high-pitched screaming at me. I have yet to forgive her for that, but we're able to get along a little. I bought a washer with some help from a former teacher recently, and told her I would need help getting it up to the apartment because we're on the third floor, and I could not afford to get it delivered. Well, she didn't help. Even afterward, when I asked her to help with cardboard, she left the apartment and went to hang out with her boyfriend. Now for the real part. She flipped out on me a few days ago. I turned down the AC because I was cleaning a lot and burning up. I never touch the AC because I never want to hear her complain. According to her, she was throwing up the next morning and couldn't work due to the fact that I had turned it down, even though it was turned off around 9 p.m. the night before, allowing for the apartment to have a chance to warm up since. She got upset at me and I told her to buy a heater like I had to get a fan. She said no because she is broke, which, to be fair, she uses all her leftover money from bills on alcohol and weed rather than necessary things. And I told her this. She goes off on me saying that I always get help with money from those around me, and I get $3,000 checks from my school, which is my FAFSA money, because I am a full-time college student along with working 5 days a week. I am also financially responsible and take care of my money. I get help from people because they know I have a rough life and I am 18 years old, learning how to live on my own still. She is 21, financially irresponsible, and goes to work maybe 3 to 4 times a week. Along with that, her mother has had to help her with rent multiple times, with it being as low as $450, rather than what it would be if she was living on her own. According to her, I am childish and selfish for not caring about her emotions, and always getting help from others. I got us a washer with that help, I got us our first month deposit with that help, and my mother sends us stuff all the time due to working at a grocery store. I ask for a little bit of help from her with necessary things and that makes me selfish. I block her on Snapchat due to constant messages of her cussing me and going off on me when I asked for her to stop and that I was not dealing with her bullshit. I honestly don't want to go back home, but I have to. It honestly sucks, and I am in such a toxic environment once again in my life with a person who is deciding to act like a high school mean girl. I'm not really asking about advice, but if anyone has any, go ahead and throw it out there. I just felt the need to vent, because I can only handle so much before I want to beat someone's ass. Which I have never gotten into a physical fight before. There's a lot more stuff that has went on, but those are the main things that I remember at this moment. 3. Crazy roommate story. I'm the homeowner, so thankfully I was able to kick them out. My wife and I had 3 roommates at one point. Pablo, 35 male, and Janine, 40-year-old female, and her son, 15 male. We had to kick all of them out. These people actually used to be our friends. We all hung out together for years, doing different things, before they ever lived with us. And when I say years, I mean like 10 years. Janine only lasted 3 months. Pablo got away for 2 years. Since we knew them, we gave them the rooms for a steal, literally like $200 a month. These two always seemed like they had their shit together, but in the end, they didn't. Moral of the story, you don't actually know how somebody is until you live with them. Let's start with Janine. In no particular order, here's what she and her son did. 3-month time span. 1, she didn't have a driver's license, but found a job 1 mile down the road, so my wife let her borrow the car to work. Stupid, I know. But we figured it's only a mile. With us doing her this big favor, it should have been obvious for her not to drive all over time, but of course, she drove all over time whenever she wanted. 2. She kept bothering me at work, phone call after phone call. She was complaining at the other roommate, Pablo, and saying he's dirty. She did clean, which was good, but the house was so clean you could eat crap off the floor. All well and good, but she was using the cleaning as a means of control. She wanted Pablo out, so she phoned me all the time to bitch about his socks being left somewhere, like the back porch. Typically afterwards I would phone him and we'd have a quick laugh. Not too long after this started, Janine took Pablo's new head trimmer and trimmed her pubic hair with it. After she trimmed it, she left the clippers out and her pubic hair all over the bathroom on purpose so it would piss him off and cause more drama in the house. This resulted in another phone call to me at work. 3. Generally, she was just loud. Her and her son would argue all the time. You could hear it like they were yelling in the same room. These arguments could last for half an hour or so. My wife grew so tired of the yelling, she eventually got pissed, and she yelled at Janine to just take a baseball bat to the kid's head. It was obviously said out of frustration, but Janine took this as an opportunity to kick a hole in the wall. Later on, when she got back from the bar. 4. Now Janine's son. On move-in day, when everyone was getting their stuff into the house, and they were getting organized, I was in the bathroom, and I hear my wife come down the hallway for the bathroom. And with almost horror, I hear her say, "Oh my god, I'm so sorry." Okay, so the kid was in there laying on the floor masturbating. I get it, it's what kids do. But lock the damn door. Now apparently, after my wife walked in, the kid's response was, "Occupied." And the way he said it, it was like it was no big deal. Like, hey, this happens all the time. The kicker is, he didn't stop after he was caught, and stayed in there for another 10 or so minutes, I'm guessing, to keep going. At least lock the damn door. Again, it's what kids do, but it gets worse. Now the masturbation in the bathroom takes a turn for the worse. About a month later, the kid was in the bathroom. All of a sudden, he comes out and says the door is broken, and makes up some bull story about how he opened it and it just broke. I looked at it, and only the top hinge had been pulled out of the frame, screws and all. The only way to do this is to happen to apply a lot of pressure to the top of the door, put your hand on top and pull down. I got a feeling he was into asphyxiation where you hang yourself, but again, it's what kids do, but god damn. The kid was the high school bully and openly admitted it to us. I was there when Janine got a call from the teacher. She starts yelling at her son as usual. She kept yelling he was gonna get in trouble. The kid was like, "Mom, Mom, Mom, I didn't get in trouble for what I did to others. I just fall back and play the victim, and I don't know who to blame." The kid was always on the dark web cruising .onion sites. He was showing me a site where you could buy a hitman to murder someone. I had to explain to him it was the cops, and anyone who buys that is going to jail for a long time. I'm just glad drugs didn't show up in my house. 5, the final straw. I woke up, and I walked down the hallway to the kitchen. Walking down the hallway, she had left the door open, with the positioning of the bed in the room you couldn't not see in there. I saw her and somebody else in there spooning. The guy's arm was across her chest, and his head was on her shoulder. Since she had been to the bar, I thought she hooked up with somebody and thought, "Wow, what trash." Wife comes out a minute later with these huge eyes and says she's in there spooning with her son. They were kicked out for real after this one. 6, move out day. Luckily for us, Janine had made it a habit to mooch off her aunt and uncle, so we told her to move back there. Uncle got there, and I was helping pack her shit in the truck. After I carried out the last box, and they were about to leave, the uncle turns to me and says, "Thanks for taking care of her this go round." Again, she only lasted 3 months. 7. As far as Pablo is concerned, he didn't pay his rent. He was just mooching as long as he could. He was always about to go get another job, always about to make it big, but in the end, he stayed in the basement for free for 2 years. Apparently couldn't afford the $200 rent. I felt bad for his old dog too. He was falling apart with skin issues, and was always crying like he was uncomfortable. After Pablo was kicked out, he left comments on my wife's business page, telling people not to buy anything. Really nice guy. He was always a stalker type too, so we see him drive by every so often. His car sounds like a go-kart though, so we know it's him before we see him pass by. But yeah, nobody is friends anymore, and the lesson learned was, you don't know who somebody is until you live with them. These fools never paid a dime of their $200 in rent either. Bye-bye, Janine and Pablo. What are your thoughts? Four. I have been living in Chicago for the past 6 months, and let me tell you, I've encountered a roommate situation that's beyond bizarre. I'm a 23-year-old guy, and I'm sharing a two-bedroom house with a 26-year-old hermit. Let me paint you a picture of my couch potato nightmare. So my roommate works as an admin assistant for a small business, and has the luxury of permanent work-from-home status. Sounds great, right? Not when it means he's permanently stationed on our shared couch, I kid you not. This guy never leaves the house, whether he's working or just relaxing in the evening. The couch is his throne. I never use that thing anymore because it stinks of his unwashed ass and his various unspecified stains all over it. Sitting on it is probably a biohazard. This situation has become suffocating and is seriously affecting my mental well-being. I've confronted him multiple times about it, but he seems blissfully unaware that his lifestyle is anything but normal. I've never had a roommate who consistently lives in the common area, and it is starting to drive me up the wall. I cannot get a moment's peace outside of my room. To make matters worse, he has very few friends and is incredibly lazy. I can count the number of times he's left the house on one hand. It's like living with a hermit crab that's taken permanent residence on our couch. I've resorted to staying in my room just to escape the weird vibe he brings to the entire house. Now, let's talk about another layer to this mess. I suspect my roommate has some serious issues, and to top it off, he is also an alcoholic. The negative behaviors associated with alcoholism are evident in his daily life, from lethargy and lack of motivation, to the impact on his overall hygiene. It's clear that his relationship with alcohol is far from healthy. He'll slam a crate of Miller's on a Tuesday night and act like that's totally normal, then get wasted on the Friday and Saturday, also alone. It's not just about the weird living arrangement. It's about living with someone whose choices are affecting their own well-being and the overall vibe of the house. Adding another layer to the strangeness, my roommate has a habit of talking to himself, whether he's muttering under his breath while working or having full-blown conversations with an imaginary audience. It adds an extra layer of discomfort to an already bizarre situation. We haven't spoken in a month because we had a big fallout over him leaving trash on the counter, so I'm basically living with a mute, alcoholic hermit who is always there. I go home from work and find this sloth in the same position as the night prior. But he says nothing like this is totally normal, watching baseball reruns over and over again. I needed to vent because I'm at a loss on how to handle this situation. Has anyone else experienced a hermit roommate or someone struggling with alcoholism and self-conversation? Any advice on how to navigate this awkward living arrangement for the next 6 months until my lease expires would be greatly appreciated. Thanks for letting me get this off my chest. 5. So I've been living in one of the Triplelink shared housing units near USC since July 2023. Here's how it's going. First, props to Triplelink for being on top of maintenance. The other tenants break things almost every day, so I've had to make a lot of maintenance requests. However, the main issue is the behavior of other tenants. Given that some of them are young college students, I'm not surprised, as I was a stupid kid in college as well. But for such an acclaimed institution, I expect the students to be more mature. Issues. 1. They do not clean up after themselves in the kitchen, literally cooking grease and sauces everywhere. Dirty dishes in the sinks. Dirty cooking pots on the stove. They bring trash from their personal rooms and leave them on the kitchen floor for someone else to take out to the dumpster that is only a 10-second walk behind the building. I have seen the trash pile up higher than the countertop, and the whole shared commons area smell like rotten eggs and fish before another tenant finally broke down and cleaned it up. I was taking care of the trash for about a month, but every time I did, they would drop another few bags on the floor before the end of the day. 3. The girl across the hall from me literally yells when she talks, and she is always talking via the speaker on the phone. She has no indoor voice. It's like she wants the entire building to hear her talking on the phone and what the other person is saying. Rent is $1,200. She cannot afford headphones or earbuds. 4. The same girl also seems to like setting the thermostat to 6 to 8 degrees Fahrenheit, and then will turn it off if I change it to 70 or 71 Fahrenheit. 5. The majority of them, leaving the locked building door wide open throughout the night. We've already had a burglary once because of this, and they still continue to leave the door open. 6. Back to the kitchen. Did I mention that someone stole my irreplaceable tumbler gifted to me by my previous employer? That and my refrigerator and cabinet space is constantly having takeover attempts, even though I was the first tenant to move in, and rightfully chose the space. Someone also stole one of the couch throw pillows from the commons area, and refuses to turn it even after management sent an email out to everyone. 7. To top it off, we are now having a loud music battle. Another tenant keeps playing music with a rich, deep bass that is waking me up every morning. I've been using a small 3-inch portable speaker to drown the sound out, but now it doesn't work as they just turn their music up. So I bought and am going to enlist a new 1000-watt 3.1 sound system with a subwoofer. I tried talking to them about their issues. Their response was,
"We don't care. Move out if you have a problem with that."
Before anyone thinks that I am being petty. Posting this as a warning to anyone looking to move into one of these units. The price is great considering it's all utilities paid, but the people I've been living with in them, student or not, are 9 out of 10 irresponsible and or inconsiderate jerks. Hellfreezer's note. I suggest you start recording things. Loud noises, keep a note of when they happen, that sort of thing. So you can then complain to your landlord about it. If it is a consistent thing, you might be able to get something done about it. Hopefully. Hey everybody, Hellfreezer here, and thank you very much for listening to Bad Roommates, Episode 9. And thank you very much to everybody who allowed me to use their stories in this video. Before you go, please hit the like button and share the video. If you'd like to get early access to these videos and support me at the same time, you can do that by joining my Patreon page, which is linked in the description. You'll also find a link to the Hellfreezer merchandise store. You can also leave a tip if you especially enjoy today's video by hitting the heart with the dollar sign that is underneath the video. And while you don't have to do that, I very much appreciate it, and it has helped me out a lot. Okay. I don't think there's any other business today, so before we go, let's have today's question and answer of the day. And today's question is, do you like hardwood floors or carpets? Personally, in my home, it's mostly carpeted floors, apart from the kitchen and bathroom, because it's not really a good idea to have carpet in there. And I would be open to hardwood, providing that the bedrooms still had carpet. I like carpet in the bedroom, and the living room, really. Not so much in other rooms. Well, actually, my office. Actually, I'm taking over more and more rooms with carpet, aren't I? Need it in my office for the sound, really. But yeah, that's my preference. I enjoy carpet, so why don't you let me know what you guys think in a comment below. And before we go, let's have the answer of the day from a previous video. And this was in relation to objects and things you were familiar with but you knew by a different name than what other people called them. And today's answer is from Emerald Angel. I'm a little embarrassed, but I didn't know a commode is another way to say toilet until well into my 20s. Well, I don't think that's embarrassing, because you know now. Okay, and with that, then we're going to head off for now. So until next time, thank you very much for listening, and take very good care of yourself.